We're arriving at Shepherd's Field. This is the cave where we're going to have Mass. This is where the angels came down on the first Christmas Eve, and here's our group all coming in. We're going to go in. I'll show you the cave before we get started. Here's the altar. This was an authentic cave. This is where the shepherds were keeping their sheep on that cold winter's night.
I proclaim to you good news of great joy. Today a Savior is born for us, Christ the Lord.
Alleluia.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that the whole world should be enrolled. This was his first enrollment when Quirinius was governor of Syria. So all went to be enrolled, each to his own town. And Joseph too went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, that is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and family of David, to be enrolled with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. While they were there, the time came for her to have her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Now there were shepherds in this region, living in the fields and keeping the night watch over their flock. The angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were struck with great fear. The angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I proclaim to you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For today, in the city of David, a Savior has been born for you, who is Christ and Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find an infant wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was a multitude of the heavenly host with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Merry Christmas.
What a great grace this is for us to be here, where the humble shepherds received this good news and were overpowered by the glory of God. We began our pilgrimage at the Mount of Transfiguration, recalling the glory of God that came down and shone in and through Jesus on Mount Tabor, where Moses and Elijah were. At the Basilica of the Annunciation, again, the glory of God came and overshadowed Mary, and she conceived the baby Jesus. And now we see again the glory of God revealed to the humble, not to the proud, just as Mary models for us that humility that if we can enter into it, he will exalt us, pointing always beyond this earth to the God of heaven who created us in his image. You and I are here. And as Steve said yesterday, Jesus was laid in a manger in Bethlehem, the house of bread. He, the bread of life, was laid in a manger, a place of eating, to anticipate what he would say in that great bread of life discourse. The bread that I will give is my flesh for the life of the world. If what we believe is not true, that would be gibberish. The bread that I will give is my flesh for the life of the world. Before God created Adam and Eve, before he said, let there be light, he knew that he would come as the light of life. And he would hand on to us that role. You and I are the light of the world. He called us to continue his ministry. And it began here. I've talked before about, and so did Steve on the bus, just talked about people who have a confused image of God, and sometimes their relationship with their own father is problematic. We often see God in terms of our fathers. And that can be a great grace, and it's an invitation to us men to model more that loving father that we are asked to emulate. But honestly, is there a man, a woman, a boy or girl who can resist a little baby? The God who created all? On my 30-day spiritual exercises, the Lord did a great healing, and it was during the meditation on the Nativity. And one of the things that I suffered, and I think to some extent I'm still dealing with, but the Lord has healed me significantly, is this desire to have everything in order, to have everything exactly the way it ought to be. I shared on the bus a little bit of why that happened when I was 13 or 14, and this desire to control, to make sure everything, that I measure up and that everything around me is working exactly as it ought to. And as I imagined this scene, actually at the Nativity, where we'll go later, I was just a 4 or 5 year old boy. The Lord allowed me in my imaginations to imagine myself like the littlest among us, 4, and helping Joseph find a place to stay. And you might say, did that really happen? It did, interiorly. For the Lord didn't come just in history. He came for me. He came for you. And I remember showing them the place, and I was just there watching in awe, not really knowing who this was, there with Mary and Joseph and the animals. And I was there, standing there, and Mary said to me, would you like to hold me? Wow, what a great grace it was. In the interior of my heart, to have Mary offer me Jesus. I held him, and he started to cry. And part of my neurosis, yep, is that I must have caused that, right? If something's wrong, it must be my fault. You might say, Father, you really were neurotic. Okay. So Joseph took Jesus from me, handed him back to Mary, and said, he's just hungry. And then he picked me up. What happened in that retreat was an honest openness to him to heal my heart. He came for you and for me. Not in some abstract way. No, he loves you in a way that you need to be loved. And you in a way that you need to be loved. And even, no, you. Normally I say even me, okay, sorry. And you. And if I could, I would come around. See, here's the problem. You're on pilgrimage, but we often doubt that he really loves us, or if he loves us, he doesn't like us. Will you let him love you, really, and heal whatever's broken and wounded in your hearts? And if the Pantocrator coming back in glory as the judge intimidates you, come close to this one and ask Mary if you can hold him. And speak those words of love that automatically radiate from your heart. When he came, before he was incarnate, he knew that crib and cross are one. And what we do well to do is have a place, a manger in our hearts, where he can be laid and grow up to the full stature of Christ.